seen a sample psychology experiment involving choice reaction time. In this video, I will provide an explanation about the script that's used to perform the choice reaction time task. For that, we're going to go to the MATLAB script. So I, again, use the command what to see what's there. And in order to see the script, we're going to use the command called edit. Choice RT, this time we do put in the suffix that M in here. So the code here is approximately, it's a little shorter than 200 lines. And this is pretty short. There's some redundancy here, but not a whole lot. One thing that I should mention in the beginning is many people, when they write codes, they use what's known as the modular functions, which means that to achieve, say, a particular task, they may have written 5 or 6 different .m files, one of which is the main file that they're calling the other scripts. Okay, that's a neat way of writing programs because it means that, say, you can have a little script that just record responses, and then in other places you can call for that script whenever you're recording responses. What I've found in my previous experience is that way of dividing the script into multiple different scripts is helpful, but it can also be difficult for debugging purposes. So for novices, I would recommend just putting your code into one script where you may have some redundancy and your coding is not as neat, but it becomes a little easier for you to figure out where error happens. As you get better and more proficient with the programming, you can start to divide your codes up into various little codes. So what I have here is the code that's used to do the choice reaction time task. At the very beginning, at the top, you can see these green lines. These are the ones that I commented out. But if you would type out in your command line, help choice RT, you would actually see the lines that I put at the beginning, okay, of the experiment that essentially tells whoever is going to run this script in the future what this program does. So my code is roughly divided into several sections. So I'm going to go over these sections somewhat quickly because I will upload this file on my website. So you will have access to the file and you can take a look at this yourself as to what it does. But I just want to point out a few places where I think it's important for us to understand what it does. So at the beginning, there is a section called experimental parameters where I cleared all the variables. I randomized the state of the clock of your computer, the internal clock, to make sure that a different randomization seed is used every time you run a participant. The order of the trials will not happen to be the same. Okay, and then I set up this preference here. This is quite specific to my laptop, that because of the screen, the type of screen it is, the screen function later on, if without this code, is going to complain and would not allow me to run. This, sometimes you will see this when you have multiple screens. Say you're presenting something on one computer, you have another monitor being connected with it, say in an MRI study, there may be a projector screen inside that you're displaying your stimuli. So the what MATLAB tries to do is to synchronize between your laptop that's presenting the stimulus and the screen that participants see, and you'll get various error messages, and you just have to deal with it depending on what the error messages tell you. So I have some basic parameters in the beginning that I will use. Say the duration of the delay after making participants made an error. Whenever we use time, the units here is in seconds, so 1 second of a delay after an incorrect response. I also specify that the intertrial interval is 0.5 seconds between trials. In addition, I specify the number of trials per block is 10. So these are variables that I put at the beginning of the experiment because sometimes I change them. So I may have blocks that are longer, say not 10 trials, but more. You know, I might want to change the intertrial interval or the duration of the delay and so on. And then we move on to a section where I specified some of the keyboard input that will be used in later sections. The command unify KB name, unify key names is to make sure that my code works for the most part on a Mac and on a Windows because these computers are somewhat different in terms of how they call the different keys. I also put in a variable key1 corresponding to the output from the command kb name, and I indicated that my Q1 is the left arrow, Q2 is right arrow, and so on. If you want to use other keyboard input as opposed to left versus right arrow, and you want to know what they're called by MATLAB, this is not just something that I dreamed up with. I called it a left arrow. It is actually something that MATLAB requires. So if you put in the command kb demo, okay, so kb demo, and you return. And suppose in your experiment, you want the input, say, to be the letter R and the letter D. Okay, so I can press, R and B, R for red. So I just pressed the letter R, and the kb demo command tells me that I pressed the key number 21. Okay, this is on a Mac. So the ASCII code 21 correspond to the button that I just pressed, which is R. So I would, in my code, if I would use that, I would say, you know, my key, red key equals to kb name, in parentheses, I would say R. Okay, so if I put B, it would say I press the key 5, which is B. Now, if I do left arrow, you can see here it says I pressed left arrow, and its ASCII code is 80, right arrow, the name is right arrow, the ASCII code is 79. Suppose I press the number 1 on top of my keyboard, you can see that the key that I pressed number 1, it has an ASCII code of 30. And in fact, it's been written out as 1 plus exclamation mark. Okay. If I would press number 1 on the right side of the keyboard, and this is my laptop, so I actually don't have that option. But suppose I had that kind of keyboard, you would see a different key code being given to that number. You would also see that instead of saying 1 exclamation mark, it's going to say 1. Because MATLAB actually treats those as two different keys. Okay, so regardless, this is an important thing. If you want to use various different keys, say, again, in MRI studies, you might want to specify a trigger that's going to synchronize with your the start of the scanner. And different systems use different triggers. Some of them might use the plus or equal sign or some of these other keys. In MATLAB, you can just figure out what this is. I should also mention that Macs and Windows, they are, once you put in the unified key names, the names of the keys should be the same. But the ASCII codes corresponding to the key number will be different. So this is one place where you would want to modify your code a little bit. If you're running this on a Windows computer, so my program is set up for Mac, so it works on a Mac. But if you have a Windows computer, you would actually want to find out what the ASCII code is for, say, the left and the right arrow used in my program, and just change those numbers for the experiment to work. So I'm just going to terminate the command and go back to the code here. So I indicated the two keys that participants are responding to. I also indicated two keys that are useful. You might have seen that I asked the experimenter to press the space bar to start a block. So the space key, I named that. Escape key is used because there, I actually, in my code later on, you'll see that I allow participants to escape out of the loop. Okay, that is, if they want to terminate the experiment before the entire, you know, two blocks of 10 trials have been completed, they can press the escape key to come out of it. Okay, so this next line here, it's a little very small, but it's actually important later on. This you might have remembered, 80 corresponds to the left arrow and 79 corresponds to the right arrow. That came out from my KB demo. And again, if you are on a Windows computer, you'll need to change these numbers in order for the code to work on your computer. And I don't know what number it corresponds to on a Windows computer. You'll just use a KB demo to find out. I then specified, since it's easier for me to call, the color for corresponding to gray, white, and black. If I'm fancy, I can also put in red, green, and blue, and so on. These are just the numbers, right? This is an array with three numbers here corresponding to the red, green, and blue channel. So 000 is to turn all these channels off, leaving you with black. The maximum number, 255, 255, and 255, so it's going to give you white because it's essentially turning all the channels on. And if you want to have red, it's going to be 255.00 because you're turning the red on and turning off the green and the blue channels. So you can just mix these numbers up to figure out exactly what color you want to use. Okay, so in our experiment, we're just displaying very simple colors. And I don't even remember whether I used all of them. The next section here is a section where I created these sounds. So that's the sound feedback given to participants, depending on whether the response was correct or not. This is just the creating variables that's holding essentially sine waves of different frequency and duration. And I put some of these sine waves together to create that da-da-da sound that you've heard, that when participants make a correct response. So these are variables that I will call later on when I decide whether the participants are correct or not. The next section is really important, but it's a section that I will probably leave you to yourself to figure out what's going on. But this is a section where you put in a login prompt, and the experimenter will then be able to enter the participant's number, their age and gender, and so on. And it uses a command known as the input dialog, okay? And you specify some parameters to it. And another command called deal is going to send what's input by the experimenter and assign them into the various variables. And all of these input variables are strings. This is the type of variable that you can, that's text. Basically, you can write it out as text. But it's not the kind that are numerals, okay? They're not numbers. So if you want to use them in a numerical way, you have to convert the strings into, say, numbers. And after that, I started to figure out whether a file with a specific name already existed in the folder. This is to make sure that I don't create a file with the same name as one that's in my folder to overwrite the file that's in there. And this is important in situations where, for instance, you've already tested participant number one. You don't want to write the same file out as participant number one again. And so what this little code does is to identify whether that file existed in the folder that you're going to write data out. If it doesn't, then what I do next is to open a file with the output name that I specified. And then I write out the title, the header of the output file with the variables that I will respond, I will record subsequent to me. Okay, so this part I'm not going over in great detail. You can try to identify what it does, but it's also a section that you don't have to remember exactly what's been done. You can just come back and refer to my coding and just modify it for your purposes. Say if you're recording different variables, you can just make changes and you can trial this out. It's pretty straightforward. The next part is important. This is where I start to open the screen function. So psychophysics is powerful in providing a way for people to display visual information. And this is through a series of commands, I would say, called the screen. They all start out with screen, but they have different parameters. And you're going to see a few of them in my code here. So we're going to start out by opening a window, okay? And I'm going to output the consequence of this command into the name of the screen handle. I call this main win. In other people's codes, I've seen that they use win or window or my window. It doesn't really matter, you know, whatever you use it. Subsequently, you just have to refer to that handle where you're presenting stimulus on as that particular name. So I'm calling that main win or the main window. It's also outputting the parameter about your screen. So if you test people on different computer screens, some of them are larger in terms of number of pixels, some of them are smaller. So what this one does is to, by default, detects what the screen parameters are, and it returns an array with four variables corresponding to the upper left coordinate in x and y, that's essentially 0 and 0, and upper and lower right, okay, that essentially is the widest x dimension on your screen and the longest y dimension on your screen. So it should correspond to the size of your screen in pixels. What I then did was to fill the screen with the background color I specified earlier, which was gray, and fill my main win with the was that, and I also just for ease of use subsequently, I know that my screen rec is an array, right? The third element corresponds to the maximum x, the fourth element corresponds to the maximum y, so I divide this by 2 to give me the center of the screen, so in pixels again. This command here, main win flip, so again, we're calling the screen function, but this time instead of opening a window, I'm flipping something onto the window. And this is important. If you skip the screen, then the command here where I fill the background, the main window with the background color is actually not going to do anything. I mean, you did it, but it's just not going to show to participants. Okay, so once I flip it, it's essentially flipping whatever is on the main window to participants instantly, so they can see everything that's on there. The next part